I did not give you their test rates to put in the Blackboard grade book, did I?
Did you, the first test one?
No, the one that we took.
Okay, no, I don't have test two.
Okay. Chelsea, I'll give you your grades that I'm about to hand over to you in here either today or tomorrow. Any surprises on the test, anything you weren't expecting? Christie Bailey? Matthew Slavy? Rebecca? Matt Latham? Sean Bumgarner? Misty Smith? Hole in a china shop. Thank you, Sarah. William Downs? Justin? Dusty? Nothing?
I think I can do it.
Try, just go ahead and see if you can. Yeah, okay. Did you put that in the computer?
Yes.
See, I did it earlier and it wouldn't read it.
Well, we had to use this and hit the computer.
Yeah, but it wouldn't, the.
Wouldn't read it.
Media player wouldn't detect that DVD. See, it's a DVD that I made myself. It looks like it's picking up something.
Yeah. Plus, this is just a DVD with black screen.
As always, there were 200 possible points on the chapter test. I'll go through and check the true/false, make sure that I graded properly and accurately. If you have any questions, just raise your hand and let me know. The true/false, number one is true, 2 through 7 are false, 8, 9, 10, and 11 are true, 12 is false, 13, 14, and 15 are true, 16 is false, 17 is true, 18 is true, 19 through 22 are all false, 23 is true, 24 is false, and 25 is true. True, false are worth 2 points each, as always. The fill in the blank are worth 5 points each. Number one is cowboy, the cowboy syndrome. 2 is significant other. 3 is self-esteem. 4 was social comparisons. 5 was the airplane passenger syndrome. 6 was unknown. 7, I accepted concept or esteem. Either one of those I accepted. 8, I accepted either risk or trust. 9 is reciprocal. And 10 was self-fulfilling. Thank you, man. We won't watch it for a while, so I just want to know that I had.
Yep, you're good.
Okay, the listing were worth 10 points each. Most people did very, very well on the listing this time. Didn't have too much trouble at all. There were a couple people that mixed them up but caught it in time and were able to correct that. Just take your time with the listing. Any questions about the listing? I don't remember anyone mixing up the list or missing the entire question at all, so that's very good. They are worth 10 points each. the matching were worth 2 points each. You should have 11, 2, 3, 15, 5. In the left-hand column going down, 11, 2, 3, 15, 5. In the middle column going down, you should have 1, 6, 9, 8, 14. Hey, Jennifer. To the test, didn't you? I didn't have a grade for it. But you were here, weren't you?
Yeah.
Somehow I didn't get in with the others.
Auntie lost it and she gets that at 200.
Yeah. I'll have to search my desk for them. That's very strange. I apologize for that. I'll check and get it to you. Chelsea's going to enter the grade. Chelsea is going to enter the grades in this afternoon, so you'd be able to check in Blackboard and see it by this afternoon or tomorrow morning. Left-hand column going down for the third time. 11, 2, 3, 15, 5. Middle column going down. 1, 6, 9, 8, 14. Right-hand column going down. 4, 13, 10, 7, 12. They were worth 2 points each. The most common mistake on the matching were introvert and extrovert, switching those around. We talked about that under factors that influence self-disclosing when we were talking about personality. And two or three people switched those around. They were worth 2 points each. The essay, much better on the essay as far as giving complete answers. Most people did very, very well. The cowboy syndrome, we talked about that. And again, most people put the full answer in there, that it is a hesitancy to self-disclose out of fear of showing weakness, and that both men and women experience the cowboy syndrome, and explain the difference in perceptions there and how they define weakness, but did a real good job with the answer. Number two, some people didn't read the question. They just told me what the windows, what the quadrants represented, what each quadrant was in the Johari window. And the question is, and that's a good way to start your answer with what each quadrant represents, but what the question is asking is, how do those quadrants change? What happens to those quadrants when one self-discloses? That's what the question is asking. And some people did a very, very good job of talking about how the open quadrant becomes bigger, the hidden quadrant becomes smaller, and went on to explain how that could affect the blind quadrant, and did an excellent job with their answers. Just make sure you're reading the questions very, very carefully. Don't assume you know what the question is going to be asking. And I emphasize that because the final is not, and I've told you this before, I don't copy and paste from the chapter text. So there will be similar questions on the final, but they may not be the exact same question. So read the true false, read the fill in the blanks very, very carefully on the final. Now the essay on the final will be the same questions. So you need to make sure that you get those answers correct. You will have, on the final, you will have had all of the essay questions before, including number three on this test will be on the final. And keep in mind that I do not give partial credit on the final. You have to have a complete answer. And I do that because I tell you the answer in class. We emphasize these questions, we go over it. You are given a heads up, just like number three, and nobody missed any points on number three because we went over it in class and I said to get 10 points credit, you have to have both a significant other and explain why, and a total stranger and explain why. And everyone did that, right? No. A lot of people missed 5 points because they only gave me one or the other. You have to include both in your answer. Remember I did A and B? Here's 5 points, here's the next 5 points. In order to get, the full 10 points, you have to have both. On the final, you have to have significant other and explain why, and a total stranger, the airplane passenger syndrome, and explain why, or you will not get any points on it. It's a 10 point question on the final test. You should have no problem because I just told you it's on there and what you will need for your answer. Okay. Okay, bring it up to me after class and I'll check it. I didn't see it apparently.
I missed 5 on number 3. I don't understand what part I missed it on.
Yeah, that's what I just said. Okay, once again, for you to get 10 points on question number 3, your answer has to have a significant other and airplanes passenger syndrome, total stranger. You have to have both of those in your answer and explain why. You have to have both of them in your answer. On this test, I gave you 5 points for one of them. On the final, I won't do that. You have to have both significant other and airplane passenger syndrome in your answer on the final test. Yes. No, we've got one.
We've got two more weeks. No,
we've got this week and next week.
But
so
we
yes,
have.
It'll be next Thursday week from this
but
Thursday.
But how many more tests do you have? 4 or 3?
We've got one. We've got, it's easier if I do it. We've got 4. We've got verbal, nonverbal, listening, and feelings. And, feelings. That's right.
Emotion.
4.
4.
And then
4 chapter tests before we're done. Other questions or comments? That's a wonderful segue. Because in order to get those 4 tests in and not take out like today's video and some things that I like to do in class, I would like to give 2 of those chapter tests on Blackboard, where you would go home at night and do the chapter tests at home on the Blackboard shelf. Is there anyone that is not comfortable with that?
I ain't got internet at home.
Can you do it in the lab here or in the library here? Chelsea, if you could, or come over to my office. Could
we can. He can take it on those computers out by your office.
It would just depend on the work schedule, though.
Okay. I don't know any other way to do that. Or I guess you could come in and make it up. Take it. We'll work something out. I'll get with you. Just make sure that I realize what the issue is and that we've got something worked out. Don't let me, don't just not take them. Let me.
We'll figure something out.
We'll get it figured out. Is there anyone else that would have problems going into Blackboard and doing it in the Blackboard shell? Everyone else is fine with that? What Chelsea and I talked about doing was opening it up after, let's say that we're going to take that test on Tuesday. What we would do is I would lecture in class on Tuesday. After class on Tuesday, we would open that Blackboard shell.
It would come open at 12:30.
And it would stay open until class starts the next day at 9:30. So you would have all day after class, all night until 9:30 to take that test the next day. Does that sound fair? Does that sound okay? I tried to set it up in a way that would be fair and that you'd have every opportunity to do that.
The time test?
No.
We did not set
it's
a
time. It's not time. And I'm pretty much, I mean, I have access to my email all the time. And if something happens and you know, accidentally get knocked out of the test or something like that, if you will just email me, I will open it for you as quick as I can.
Does everyone have Chelsea's email address that I put on the board?
And it's anytime
when we take a break, get it from Chelsea.
Anytime that like, as soon as you open the test or like, you know, you're going to click, like you're going to look down the Blackboard tab and you're going to see exams. Whenever you click that and open it and you open up your test, there's going to be an announcement that's going to pop up on your screen, you know, with all the information worth 200 points, et cetera, it's not timed. My email address will always be in that announcement, okay, and that announcement will stay open the whole time that you take the test. So,
we'll, is that okay?
We'll help you out as best we can. I mean, as soon as you leave the, as class is over, that test will come open. Is that what you're asking?
You don't understand. You see, when I start doing it, then maybe I got something coming up.
I don't think you can open it. And then
you can stop. Yeah, you can come back anytime, as long as you start it before. I mean, as long as, like, you know, you leave here, you start the test, and you have to fix dinner or something like that, you can close it out, and you can come back to it.
Okay, good.
I've set it up to do that. Yeah, you can come right back to it.
Isn't she wonderful? Any other questions or problems?
I wish I could have gotten you a camera.
I'm only envisioning doing that with two of the chapter tests. The other two will be done in class.
How are the listing and the other questions that are longer? How's that?
I'm going to have to go in and grade. Chelsea and I will grade the listing.
The only thing you will grade is the essay. The listing and everything else is set up to grade. It's just set up, say for instance, if you're doing like a fill-in-the-blank question and it has two words, that question is going to prompt you to enter those two words in two separate blanks underneath the question.
And there will be very few that have.
Very, very few.
The thing that concerns me is, like on this test, I accepted two different words. I'll have to go in and check those. Mm-hmm. And the same thing with the listing. That's why I thought I'd have to grade the listing.
Okay, I can set that up to be graded.
Yeah, let's just set it up for me to grade. Save any trouble.
Okay.
I'll grade the fill in the blank, the listing, and the essay.
Okay, so you will not get a score whenever you finish. He has to. John will have to go in and grade everything. And I wasn't for sure. I know that you stress spelling on your tests, right?
If I can make it out, you know.
Okay. Well, then
I think I need to go in and grade.
Okay. Well, I can change that to be a pattern match instead of an exact match. As long as it's somewhat close, it'll be accepted.
I would feel more comfortable with me grading the fill in the blank, the listing, and the essay.
Well, the score has to be approved by you before it posts.
Okay.
So you'll get to look at everything before it posts.
Okay. So that should take care of that, shouldn't it? Yeah, matching is set up so it will be scored. There's only one option with the matching and with true false, so that should be.
So will this be open tomorrow after class, or is this?
Yes.
It will open.
The Chapter 5 test will be open tomorrow after class.
It will open at 12. I think I will probably set it to open at 11:45 just to be safe.
And the other one that I envision doing, and the reason that I'm doing this, I want to have time to review for the final. I want to go through the final, give you a study guide for the final, go through that in class. And if we don't do this, then I'm not going to have time to do that. And I think it would be better for you if we could review for the final and go over the study guide. So, yes, my plan is to have that one open, Chapter 5 open after class tomorrow, and then the meaning, the feeling chapter, I keep saying meaning, the feelings chapter, we would do that, it would be open after class, I think I said, on my calendar I have for
the
Tuesday,
11th.
After class on Tuesday. So Wednesday, you'd get the scores of that test probably, I'd go over that test with you anyway. And you'd get the study guide, we'd go over the study guide, prepare for the final, and the final would be on Thursday. Otherwise, we wouldn't have that Wednesday to review for the final.
Just if you get locked out of the test, your electricity goes off, your computer, you know, acts funny or anything like that, don't panic about being locked out of the test. I promise I'm never more than about 10 minutes away from my email, and I'll be really, really sure to check it, you know, keep checking in on Tuesday night. And I'll get you back in the test as quickly as possible. Don't freak out or panic or think that I'm going to avoid you or anything like that. I can remember being a student and that happening to me before. And, you know, I would absolutely panic and be almost about to cry because I was afraid I wouldn't get to take my test. But don't worry. We'll get you back in as quickly as possible. And if it messes up again, you can email me and we'll we'll figure it out.
Okay, any questions about the test that I just handed back or about anything coming up schedule-wise as far as the course? Sir?
I just have a question on this one. I'm pretty sure I know what I missed. I just want to make sure it was A and B, right?
Okay, on the listing, that is the factors that influence self-disclosure. We had personality, cultural expectations, gender, to whom, topic, and dyadic effect.
So how's the checklist?
You have
5 pages?
No. Okay. We're in order now. We're going to do, today is verbal language, then nonverbal language, listening, and meaning and feelings. Or emotion. That's why I'm getting screwed up. They say emotion instead of feelings. Okay, chapter 5.
Did I get that right in order?
Okay, chapter 5. We just covered, we are going to begin,
I'm getting all mixed up now.
Chapter 5 is what we're covering today. Chapter 5 deals with verbal language and how we communicate through speech, through our verbal language. The next 3 chapters especially, the verbal chapter, the nonverbal chapter, and the listening chapter, are very, very important to the course. A lot of information in these chapters. So you definitely want to stay alert and take good notes as we are lecturing on these and working through this this week, because bulk of the essay or the final questions will come from these chapters. Verbal language. When we talk about verbal language, our main objective as effective communicators, what we're trying to accomplish as effective communicators, is transferring meaning from one person to another person. I want you to understand what I'm saying, what I'm talking about. I want to transfer meaning from me to you. So when we talk about verbal language, our main objective is the transfer of meaning from one person to another. Now, your book begins with a big long list that they call the nature of language. What I would like to do for your notes, I'm going to create this list. I'm going to take the first at least quarter of the chapter and combine all of those pages into one neat list called The Principles of Meaning. If our main objective as effective communicators is transferring meaning from ourselves to someone else, we have to understand the nature of meaning, the nature of language, as they say in the book. We have to understand how meaning works, how language works. So these principles are things that we know to be true about language. If you're trying to follow along in the textbook as I'm going through this, you'll probably get pretty frustrated. The best way to do it is to get the notes the way that I put them on the board, and then you can go back later and kind of highlight as you go through the book. They've got them in bold, but I've changed a couple of words around, and they're not numbered in the book, so I think it would be easier just to get your notes. These are things that we know to be true about meaning, or, since the book is using the term language, we can do this, meaning or language. Meaning is symbolic, is number one. The first thing that we know about meaning, the first thing that we know about language is that the word is not the thing. What the heck does that mean? The word is not the thing. The word that we use to describe something or to stand for something is just a symbol. The word that we use is just a symbol that represents an object or a sensation, a feeling. a thought or an idea. The words that we use to communicate are just simply symbols that are fairly random. They change very, very quickly from person to person, from place to place. You do not have to travel very far, very far at all, to find differences in language and differences in the symbols that we use to represent objects. And some of you have traveled great distances, been overseas, and you'll catch on right away to what I'm talking about. Language is symbolic. The words that we use are just symbols representing objects. When I grew up in New England, Massachusetts, and then moved to Kansas, I was stunned, amazed, shocked to hear this called a pop. That was the coolest thing in the world for me. I had never heard this called a pop before. So I was ordering pop for breakfast every chance I got just so I could say pop. I just thought that was the coolest thing. I grew up, this was called a soda. You got a soda. I was corrected the other day because, where was I? And they said, you're supposed to say Coke. It's a Coke. But I didn't want a Coke. But that was the symbol to represent all pops. You just say a Coke. It changes very, very quickly from person to person, place to place. It changes over time. Anyone been in Boston, downtown Boston, around the Commons area? It's not unusual at all. If you walk around downtown Boston, they will put out little signs, placards on the sidewalk, and they're usually chalkboard or dry erase marker boards. And they'll have, like the restaurants and the pubs and different places, will have their specials on those chalkboards. Around those dry erase marker boards, those signs. And it's not unusual at all to see signs that say, ice cold tonic, a dollar. If you're in Boston, this is a tonic. I want a Dr. Pepper tonic. Same thing, probably bottled in the same plant. Same exact stuff. It's just a different symbol representing that stuff, that object. When I first moved here from Kansas, I was teaching a speech class in Russell County. And we were giving speeches, the first semester that I was in Kentucky, we're giving speeches, and a girl's giving a speech in class about how to dress properly in bitter cold weather. And she starts at her feet, you know, with the socks and the boots and everything, and goes all the way up. She gets to the top of her head, and she said, and you make sure you wear a toboggan. Toboggan. Where I grew up, what is a toboggan? Yeah, that around here it's a winter cap. It's a hat. Where I grew up, a toboggan is a long wooden sled that has a curve on the end. It's wood. And you think I'm crazy? Go to eBay and Google toboggan. You will get long wooden sleds. In most of the country, a toboggan is a sled. It's not a hat that you wear. Sometime years ago, the people determined the symbol that they were going to use to represent this object was toboggan. I had a student just a couple of years ago, I was talking about this, and they started laughing. They said, it happened to me. I went up to Ohio State to an Ohio State football game, and it was freezing. We weren't expecting it to be so cold, so we went down the street to a Kmart. And I asked the guy where their toboggans were, and he took us all the way back to Sporting Goods and showed us the sleds. We didn't know what he was talking about. That symbol, that same symbol, is used to describe two very, very different objects. It changes over time. When I was a little kid, and this was not unusual at all, kindergarten, first grade, they used to pin notes to our jackets or sweaters. This was before everyone had fancy book bags and everything. They would pin a note to our sweater so mom would see it. And it was not unusual at all for me to have a note. They would have standard mimeograph notes that they would put on that would say, the playground is muddy. Please make sure your child wears rubbers tomorrow. You know what a rubber is? You know what a rubber was then? Yeah, every kid, when you got your school supply list, every, at the beginning of the year, there'd be crayons, there'd be Big Chief notebooks, there'd be pencils, and there'd be rubbers on there. And rubbers, they're galoshes, is what the real term for them is. And they, I don't even know if you can buy them anymore. I haven't seen them forever. But you would stretch them over your shoes. They kind of look like a rubber shoe. And you would stretch it over your shoes. Every kid had them. But if my daughter came home from a Hopkins Elementary today with a note in her book bag that said, make sure Katie brings her rubbers tomorrow, I would think, what in the world is going on? That symbol has changed over time. Look at the word gay. My grandmother could say, we had a gay time at bingo Friday night, and I would know what she meant, but that means something completely different in this day and age. My point is that the symbols change. And if you are going to be an effective communicator, you have to adapt and adjust and not expect, there I am with adapt and adjust again. I say that a lot this class. If you're going to be an effective communicator, you have to adapt and adjust to the changes in those symbols. Very important for the text. Meaning, let me start over again. People create meaning. Words do not. People create the meaning. As long as you decide as a culture, as a group, that this is the symbol that you're going to use to represent a certain object, then you're fine. You can communicate that. But someone else comes into that circle, into that culture, and they don't know what you're talking about. They're not familiar with the use of that symbol. People create meaning, words do not. If I took this and I said, okay, class, for the next 2 weeks until the end of this class, this is going to be a banana. We're going to call this a banana. Right? So I come into class tomorrow and I say, okay, we're going to work on the study guides. Please get your bananas in a circle. You would know what I'm talking about. But Jennifer is not here today. She comes in tomorrow. She's going to think we're crazy because she didn't hear that we were going to use that symbol to represent this object. We didn't change this. You can't peel this and eat it now. All we did was change the symbol representing this object. The point is that you have to be flexible as a communicator, and you have to expect those changes, those differences. Certainly one of the most drastic examples, I was in summer class a few years ago. We were meeting, it's been a while because we were meeting over in the little theater. And I was giving this discussion, I was talking about this, and two girls in the back were laughing, kind of giggling. And I finally stopped and said, what's going on? What are you guys talking about? Well, one of the girls that was laughing had been a foreign exchange student the year before. And she went to Norway, and she was telling the story that when she got off the plane at the airport in Norway, the host family was there with a big welcome. They had big signs and everything, welcome to Norway. She gets off the airplane, comes down, meets the family, goes down the line, meets the family. She gets to the host mother in Norway, who gives her a big hug and says, oh, it was such a long flight from New York City, you must be exhausted. Would you like to go home and take a douche? She's, what? What did she mean? Does anyone know?
What?
A shower. Well, that was the symbol. Can you see how it can cause embarrassment and misunderstanding if we don't expect there to be differences in those symbols? Meaning is very contextual. I've used that word a lot too. Remember the big circle we drew around the process? Meaning changes depending on where you are, who you are talking with. Changes over time. It's very, very contextual. The word is not the thing. The word is just a symbol representing an object. People create the meaning. Words do not. Okay, number two. language or meaning. Is very rule governed. And that's a term that they use a lot in this course, rule governed. It means that we have very specific expectations as to what is appropriate and what's not appropriate. Our word usage. Again, the idea of it being contextual plays into this very, very much. That our language is very rule governed. What's appropriate with your buddies out driving around on the weekend is absolutely not appropriate when talking to your grandparents or talking to your boss. We change. If we break those rules, let me go back and say most people change their speaking habits. Most people adapt and adjust to the different contexts because language is rule governed. Most people do that. They speak differently. They adapt their language. Have you ever known someone that you're in a social setting and they can't talk without cussing? Yeah, and you're embarrassed and you're uncomfortable about it? Very rule governed. So people have different reactions and different responses when those expectations are broken. What's culturally accepted and not. Very, very rule governed. Number three, language, meaning, varies in directness. When I underline something, that's for emphasis, and those are good vocabulary terms to get in your notes. Language varies in directness. We have language that is very, very direct. We would say blunt. That's what we mean when we say direct. There's no guesswork to it at all. It is very, very specific. It is very, very blunt. They tell you what they think. Very specific. That is what direct means. Indirect means, my mom would say that you hem and haw a little bit. That you set the person up, you prepare the person for the message. There's a lot of small talk. Here's a good vocabulary term. In indirect language, there's a lot of phatic communication. Phatic communication is just a fancy way of saying small talk. It's stuff that's not real important to the major message, to the main message of the conversation. It's just small talk. Prepares you for what you're about to say. That's phatic communication. So direct language is very to the point. It's very blunt. There's no build up to it. The person walks in the room and they let it fly. Indirect, there's a lot of feed forward. You remember feed forward from chapter 1? Where you say things like, sit down, I need to talk to you a little bit. This is kind of important. And you build up towards the message. Now, indirect messages are, neither one of these is negative. Neither one is bad. Direct messages are not bad. Direct messages can be very, very appropriate. Indirect messages are not bad. In certain situations, they can be very, very appropriate. Can you think of an example when you would use an indirect message? When you prepare the person for what you're about to say, you get them ready for what you're about to say.
Doctors before they give them a diagnosis?
Absolutely. Some doctors use indirect messages if they're about to give bad news. They have doctors they call bedside manner, where they build up to that. Some doctors are very, very direct. They don't beat around the bush at all. They come right in and tell you what's going on. Remember House on TV? House never used indirect messages in any situation. He was very direct. He was very blunt. So you would use indirect messages to build up. If you've got bad news, you would let them know that. Any other times that you would use an indirect message? Can you think of a time? Example? Situation?
Breakup.
A what?
Breakup.
A breakup? Okay. Anytime we use indirect messages a lot, the most common situation or most common context is when there's emotions involved, when we're trying to protect someone's feelings, when we're building up to bad news. One of the terms that they use a lot when talking about indirect messages is saving face. To save face. Have you ever heard that phrase or that term? To save face? It really is emphasized and really prioritized in the Eastern languages, Asian cultures. To save face means to protect someone's reputation. You don't want to make someone look bad. So you use an indirect message. If you're a manager, if you're managing a company, it could be a restaurant, could be a business, whatever it is, and you're managing, and one of your best staff members, this person's usually very sharp, very dependable, you can count on them. They're one of your best employees, but they mess up. They screw something up, they didn't do it right, it affected the company negatively, whatever. And you've got to address that. You've got to deal with that in the staff meeting so that it doesn't happen again, so that no one else does that. So in that staff meeting, you would probably use indirect messages to get that across. You wouldn't center, put them in the spotlight or single them out and put blame on them. You would probably use indirect messages. We had a situation last week, and this is what happened. You would use indirect messages to allow that individual to save face. I remember when I was a little kid, we were in Massachusetts. My dad was a Baptist minister. I think I shared that with you the other day. And in Massachusetts, our house was right next door to the church. Part of the Christian Ed building came into our backyard, right next door. And in those days, it wasn't unusual for two places to have the same phone number. The church and our home had the exact same phone number. So if the phone rang in the church, it rang at our house and vice versa. One weekend, a couple friends of ours from New York State came to visit for the weekend. And being the fun family that we are, we took them to the pancake dinner in the church fellowship hall. And we were sitting there with Paul and Mary, the couple that were visiting. We're eating our pancakes, and the phone rings. And my dad gets up and goes into the church kitchen, answers the phone, comes back to the table to the husband of the couple that's visiting us and says, "Paul, the phone's for you." Paul says, "For me?" He gets up and goes into the kitchen, talks on the phone for a little bit, comes back out, looks at his wife, and said, "Mary, hurry up and eat your pancakes. We gotta go, your dad just died." And sits down. And everyone just was stunned, was shocked. What just happened? They're divorced now, by the way. He used a very direct message in a situation where an indirect message would have been much more appropriate. So you can see that neither one of these is negative. Neither one of these are bad. They both have their appropriate usage. Language meaning varies in directness. Okay, very important, major points on the test. Wake up and make sure you get this one. Meanings and language vary in levels of abstraction. Meaning varies in levels of abstraction. And your book uses some kind of funky slide chart. I'm not going to be able to find it. Yeah, it's almost like a ladder to illustrate how meaning varies in levels of abstraction. I think it's a lot easier to create a model that looks like what we call an inverted pyramid to illustrate the levels of abstraction. What levels of abstraction mean is, what that means is that our language goes from very, very vague to very, very specific. It goes from very, very vague to very, very specific. The top of this pyramid is very vague. If I asked you to close your eyes and picture a pet, close your eyes and picture a pet, everybody in here would probably have a very different picture in their mind. Well, all kinds of things. Pet, that word is high abstract. Pet is high abstract. That means that it can mean different things to different people. It's not very specific. It's very open to interpretation. Everyone has a different picture. Okay, now, the principle is that it varies in levels of abstraction. Each level, as we go down this pyramid, becomes more specific as we go down the pyramid. So, I want to be a little bit more specific than pet. What would I say? Cat. Can I use dog?
Yeah.
Thank you. It would be easier than cat. Okay, so now we've eliminated parrots and fish and gerbils and guinea pigs and cats. We know that the individual is talking about a dog. What's a little bit more specific than dog?
Breed.
Okay, let's put big dog in here first. I probably should only put three lines in there. We know it's a big dog. Now what? Someone said breed. Can we use breed? Give me a breed of a big dog.
Blue tick.
Blue tick.
Blue tick? Okay. So now we know that it's not, when we did this, we eliminated poodles and chihuahuas and Lhasa Apsas and all the little breeds of dogs. We know now, we've got a pretty good idea of what kind of dog we're talking about. Pretty clear picture if you know what a blue tick is. What is the most specific term that we could use for that dog? If I call the vet, and this happens, I call the vet and say I'm bringing my dog in for her shots. Okay. Now the receptionist knows that it's a dog, and if, depending on the shot, she needs to, the first thing she asks me is which dog are you bringing in, because she's got the file. But they need to know whether it's a big dog, how much it weighs, and they've got that on record. Then they need to know big dog, small dog, whatever kind of dog it is. And then she'll ask me, what's the name of the dog? Is it Toffee or is it Callie? Callie weighs 12 pounds. Toffee weighs maybe 5 wet. So they have to know very, very specific, my dog Toffee. That's low level of abstraction. Very, very specific. Very, very specific. We went from the very abstract to the very specific. How about if I did this? How about if I said, my idol is an athlete. My idol's an athlete. Okay, very abstract. You have no clue who that is, who I'm talking about. What would be a little bit more specific than that? Football player. And if we assume that we're talking about a professional football player, and we could say professional football player there, or NFL player. There are 32 teams, 53 football players on each team. that math. So that's a whole lot of people. Can we be more specific than that? What team he plays for? What's a little bit, now we've gone from, that would probably, would we be in the thousands? Hundreds to 53. Can we be even more specific? Position, right? He plays wide receiver. Okay, so now we've gone from thousands, from millions, to hundreds, to 53, to, they'll probably keep seven on the roster. So we're down to seven people. What's going to be the most specific? If I called the Buffalo Pro Shop and said I want a player's jersey, that's not going to be enough information for them. What do I need to tell them?
Number.
Player's name and number. So now they know exactly what I'm talking about. Let me do one more example, real world example for you, and then I'll talk about why this is important to us. When I was teaching over in Russell County, I taught on Wednesday night, and I had a lot of people in that speech class, 32 I think we started out with, which is an incredible number for a speech class. We were there very late at night after 10 o'clock trying to get through class to get everybody done. I would go over, when I got done here, I would go over to Russell County a little bit early, I'd get something to eat, I'd walk around the Kmart a little bit, wake up some before I went to class. Our youngest son, Jared, who was in grade school at the time, caught on that Daddy was going to Kmart before class on Wednesday nights. So one night, I'm heading out the door to go to class, and Jared stops me and said, "Hey, Dad, when you go to Kmart tonight, give me a toy." Okay? Very, very high abstract language. Jared used a high abstract word, but he had something low abstract in mind.